The Habata gaming chair. Is the H silent? Is it just Bata? I'm gonna go with Habata. Gaming chair on Amazon.com is about $150. I've only had mine for about 2 weeks and I've already requested a return. Let's talk about why. Straight out of the box, I was thinking to myself, the build quality seems decent, but it seems like it's done with subpar materials. I immediately made note of the fact that the PU leather is not only very, very thin, but it just seems poorly fitted over the chair. There's just sections where you can sort of get a hold of it and it's not pulled taut over the cushions. Additionally, the plastic casements that go over top of the reclining mechanism seem pretty chintzy and just sort of prone to cracking or breaking if you were to bump them up against things. However, in spite of these sort of poor quality items that I found out of the box, I thought that the base inspired a bit of confidence and was pretty well built, something that I could trust while tilting or reclining, which I couldn't really say from my last chair. A lot of times I'll just barely lean back and I thought I was going to fall straight into the abyss. The tilt mechanism as well, I thought seemed really solid and would prove to be pretty high quality as well as where the piston mounts to it. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. As I mentioned, I've had this chair for about 2 weeks now. So let's start off with some of the things that I noticed day one, some of the things that were immediately evident after using the chair. First time I sat down in this chair, I noticed that it wasn't super solid where the tilt mechanism meets the piston, and it had a bit of wiggle left to right. It just sort of seems like at any given moment the chair could snap off of the piston, flop you on the floor. Additionally, before I even sat in the chair, I gave it a little like spin around, and I immediately noticed that something in the reclining mechanism was making a clicking noise back here. I don't know if it's the spring or some sort of latch, but it's never gone away, and I'm not going to bother taking it apart to try and fix it because I'm sending the damn thing back. Another thing that I pretty quickly noticed was that the pillow falls in the total wrong spot, at least for me. Now, that could be different for people of varying sizes and heights. However, I kind of hate that I have to pull the thing up and out from behind my back every time I sit down. If I don't, if I lay my head back, sometimes I hit it on these plastic pieces that are here for aerodynamics and going fast. It only took one look walking up on this thing to think to myself, man, this chair is really thin. And that's not to say that it's lacking structural integrity. It's got a really solid metal frame running through all of the pieces of the chair. The problem is there's just no cushioning. There's no padding, which is why it looks so thin. And naturally, you want to try and adjust and find a way to be comfortable in this chair that has no padding, but there's metal frame running through all of the bolsters, and it just grinds into you and makes it so that even when you're trying to grasp for comfort, you just can't find it anywhere. Just putting a slight bit of hand pressure on the cushion sort of makes it clear how much it depresses, and then it almost breathes back in the air as it reinflates because this foam is just so thin and just tries to retake its form as soon as you let go of it. I will say though, one thing that I absolutely love about this chair is the recline feature. It goes like 155 or 160 degrees flat, and I'm not even sketched out doing it either. Like, I can go all the way back and even engage the tilt to the point where I feel like my head's touching the floor, and I rarely think I'm about to flip the damn thing. Most of the chair's glaring flaws were pretty evident from day one, which is probably not a good thing. However, there were certain issues that became much more problematic the longer that I used the chair, and the most glaring of those happened to be the armrests. The armrests are only adjustable up and down, and you can move them in and out. However, you have to go underneath the chair, loosen all of the Allen screws, and then adjust them, then retighten them. And these are as far in as they'll go right now, and even in that state, they are not close enough together for my taste and the way that I like to hold my mouse and keyboard. Of course, it doesn't stop there. The padding on the armrest is essentially non-existent, putting it right in line with the rest of the chair, but the left armrest slowly over time has gotten so loose that it probably has 3+ inches worth of play at the top of the armrest. Now, I had my previous chair for 10 years or something along those lines. If any of you have watched my videos, you've seen the poor skin cancer-ridden mess that was my previous chair, which is why I'm trying to get a new one. But that chair didn't start squeaking for, I would guess, at least 7 or 8 years until finally it started to squeak. This chair, I've only had it for 2 weeks and it's already a squeaky mess. all I have to do is just sit down and things start squeaking and then slightly moving back and forth. But if I go full tilt, and I don't mean like getting angry at a video game, if I go full tilt with this thing, it is just screaming at me the whole time. The last couple little things that I noticed after using it for a while was the lumbar pillow is kind of pointless, and sometimes I like it and sometimes I don't, but it's such a pain in the ass to take on and off because you have to completely unstrap it from the back, pull it through the bottom, and it's just not worth it. So for the most part, I just leave it off completely. And though I did say that I really like the recline function, it's a little bit aggressive coming back up if you don't basically do a crunch along with it to make sure that it doesn't just fling up. It'll punch you in the back of the head and maybe knock you out if you're not careful. Or if you're pretty lightweight, you might just get catapulted straight out of the damn thing and into your monitor. So bottom line on the Ciabatta Bread gaming chair. It's cheap for a reason, man. And if your budget is $150 and you see all these glaring flaws and all this discomfort and issue and you can deal with that, you know what you're getting into and you understand that the way the market's structured, paying $150 for a chair isn't going to get you something that you're going to love. But if that's your budget, I think it fits the bill okay, to be honest. Now, I'm dumb and I haven't bought a chair in 10 plus years. I thought this was actually going to be a pretty sick chair, but, you know, made by an off-brand, so it'd be cheap. And I was wrong, so I'm going to be buying a new chair here in a few weeks. So tune in next month or something for a review of a $400 gaming chair instead. Now, the reality is, if you're looking for comfort and looking to take care of your body, you probably shouldn't be buying a gaming chair anyway. But I'm a video game YouTuber, so if I don't buy an Epic gaming chair, nobody's going to take me seriously, obviously. And I'm probably never going to get another subscriber in my life. But for the average user, you should probably just buy a chair that's going to be comfortable and last a long time and not pay an upcharge for gamer swag, I guess. There is a reason that Herman Miller's and Steelcase's cost like $1,000+ and are known for being super comfortable and functional. Of course, I believe there are diminishing returns, especially once you get beyond, I would guess, a few hundred dollars. So bottom line, would I recommend buying it? No, of course I wouldn't. The fact of the matter is that when you're buying something that is for your health, for your comfort, and for your happiness while doing a hobby that makes you happy, you need to buy better. Thanks a lot for watching, and I'll see you next time.